but we're not officially started.
Are we doing this weekly?
Well, weekly as in once a week. Like, once an actual week, not in-game.
Okay.
I mean, at least once a week. If we can fit in two shows a week, we'll do it. But, I mean, you work a night schedule.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to, like, put a strain on your sleep. You know?
Yeah. And we wouldn't be able to do it this late anyway.
Yeah. Alright, did you post anything about it in the chat?
No, not yet.
Alright, I'll post the link. Okay, so what do you want to talk about first?
Let's talk about matchups this week that we find that are huge, that could serve be huge throughout the
Should we start with standings? Give like the playoff picture.
Yeah, let's start with standings. Let's start with the standings, and I'll spew off the playoff picture. Should we go divisional standings first, or just NFL?
Division. Right now we got the AFC North. The Bengals in the lead at 4-2. Browns 3-4. Ravens 3-5. The Steelers 3-5. Or 2-5. Excuse me.
Tootie, what? Okay, of these four teams, what team do you think will pull out on top?
It's anyone's guess. This division is so closely grouped together. An injury here, an injury there could catapult the Steelers up to the top, drop the Bengals into the middle. Who knows? We got to wait for this to play out. With most of their division schedule still ahead of them.
I totally agree with you. The Bengals, you know, they've been doing really well. I believe they lost, or no, they won last week. Where everybody else is on a losing streak. Either this week or last week. So, but I think who would be in the lead in this division? I have a feeling that the Ravens and the Bengals will vie for a playoff spot, whether that be wild card or division.
Yeah, that Week 17 matchup is looking like it's going to be just a winner take all, one man leaves alive affair.
Alright, let's see, the AFC South, the Colts, 4-3, the Jaguars, 3-4, the Texans are 3-4, and then the Titans bottom out at 1-5. Which team do you like the most here?
It's a toss-up between the Colts. They've got the lead right now, but the Texans are kind of a wild card with a new coach. Seems to know what he's doing about Madden. They're not too far back. And they've already won one matchup with the Colts the previous.
That's true. And I believe the Texans did win last week, right?
Yes, they beat the Dolphins 23-17 in Miami.
And that was, I found that a surprise because that was the Dolphins' first loss.
Yeah, I felt they dropped one that they should have won. I really do. As the Texans took it in overtime.
Oh, yeah. definitely. But, you know, I wouldn't say a surprise team right now, because the Jaguars, who were 0-4, are now 3-4. They've won 3 in a row. But I'm not sure what their identity is on offense or defense right now. Because, you know, obviously they have a young quarterback. They have Julius Thomas, which tight ends are really the thing in this league right now. But
they're on a 3-game win streak.
Yeah. They are. But I don't know how long that will last. That's my problem. I don't know how long that will last. But I do agree with you, it's between the Colts and the Texans.
Alright. Up next, what do we got? AFC. They're gonna be the worst. East.
AFC East.
Yeah, that one.
Yep. That one is really close. Like, two teams are really standing out. But
the Dolphins and Pats, the Patriots, the traditional power of the division. The Dolphins spent a lot of money to get in this position.
That's very true. And right now, the Dolphins are leading the Patriots. But I mean, that will change depending this week, because I believe the Dolphins face the Patriots. That's one of our matchups that we'll be talking about later. But
which something that could turn that matchup. Ryan Tannehill is not going to be available for it. He's missed the last two games with a broken hand.
That's crazy. And, you know, with Tom Brady and Rob Gronkowski doing some amazing things this year, I believe Gronkowski is, third or fourth on the list of receiving yards or receptions, you know?
I believe he's second.
That up. Okay, yeah. Gronkowski. I don't know who can match up with Gronkowski on the Dolphins secondary. You don't want to match him up with a linebacker, that's for sure, but I don't know. And you also have Edelman in there who can work in between, you know, coverages, so I'm gonna
I agree with that.
That's my prediction. Granted, the Chiefs have been doing good. They're on a 4-game win streak. But the Broncos earlier, granted, there was a coaching change in the last 4 weeks, which led to those 4 victories. But the Broncos did well on the Chiefs earlier. And even if the Broncos lose to the Chiefs this time, I don't think the Chiefs can overcome the Broncos. Like you said, Peyton Manning has to feel his age to do that. But I'd say it's between the Broncos and Chargers. And maybe even the Raiders. The Raiders did start off good, but we need to see some games from them.
Potentially, I could see the Broncos losing 4 games, because the game against the Packers this week, that's going to be a killer game.
That's going to be a tough matchup, and we'll talk about that
later. If the Chiefs want to get back in the division, they've still got 2 games to play against the... Or no, they've got 1 game to play against the Broncos. Excuse me.
Yes, they do. But I believe...
The Chargers have both their games. So you've got the Packers. That game is a toss-up. That one is 2 undefeated teams. Or 1 undefeated, 1-1 loss going at it. And you got the Chiefs, who have been hot. They're on fire. You got the Patriots week 12.
I agree, followed by the
Chargers. Then week 16, you've got the Bengals at home and then the Chargers at home. So those are some playoff contending teams in the home stretch.
I agree with you. All 4 teams in the AFC West are contending teams. Well, I believe it's it might be the only division that have teams that are above 500. Maybe 1 or 2 divisions.
It is the only team that only division that has all 4 teams above 500.
So that AFC West is gonna change up that playoff picture right now. Alright, let's talk NFC. We have the NFC North with the Packers at 6-0, the Vikings at 2-4, the Lions at 2-6, and the Bears at 1-5. Obviously, this is the Packers division.
Yeah, there's no
doubt about it.
There's not much to say. There's been major upheaval with the other 3 teams in the division, and it shows in their record. The Packers.
Which team do you think will need to improve next year the most?
The most?
Out of the Vikings, Lions, and Bears.
Improve the most would be the Bears. So the Lions and Vikings have young talent. The Bears have an older quarterback in Jay Cutler, who's not doing very well this season. He's been a key component to a lot of those losses. And it's amazed me that it's taken this long, but I really feel like people are starting to turn on the thought of him being star caliber quarterback. He's thrown for 1,300 yards, 8 touchdowns, and 5 picks in the Bears' 6 games. He's only completing 59% of his passes for a paltry 7.5 yards per attempt. So he's not setting the world on fire. Forte's just shut down. Forte's had 252 yards. I think this is the end of the line for him in Chicago. The lone bright spot is Alshon Jeffery, and he's been making you-know-what into chicken salad. 28 catches for 420 yards. There's just not much
totally
you can say.
I agree with you. I think the Bears need to
step up at a lot of positions. Because they've got talent that they could make a playoff run if the stars align. But right now, the sky's looking pretty cloudy.
I agree with you. Let's move on to the South. We have the Falcons at 7-0. I believe the only, one of 2 undefeated teams. We have the Panthers at 5-1. The Buccaneers at 4-2. And then we have the Saints bottoming out at 0-7. what do you feel about this division so far?
This division is just a house of horrors when other teams have to step up to play them. The Panthers, 5-1. They're 5-1, and yet they've allowed more points than they've scored. You know why that is? Their one loss is to this juggernaut, the Atlanta Falcons. 7-0, they've scored 200 more points than they've allowed. This team is the cream of the crop in the league right now. They are just crushing every statistic there is, and I only see them maybe losing one game. I see them cruising to home field advantage at 15-1.
And I agree with you. I agree with you. You know, the Falcons are just number one scoring offense. Number one in defensive points allowed. You know, I mean, they have the least. That's what I mean. You know,
yeah, they've got the number one scoring defense.
That's not a lot of points. So people need to find a way to stop.
I'd have to do research, but I'm pretty sure that is on pace to break the lowest amount of points allowed in a season.
And I could be wrong.
I could be wrong, but I believe the record is around 158.
Yeah. We're only halfway through right now. We're only at week 8, which is kind of in the middle, and they still have a game to play. But as for contenders for the wild card, I do like the Panthers, and the Buccaneers have lost 2 in a row. They lost their great start. But I do believe the Panthers will get that wild card spot, despite what the point differentials that they have. They might not score a lot of points, but they won't allow a lot of points either. Granted, again, as you mentioned, the Falcons did make one quick whooping. But, you know, right now, of the lowest, least points allowed, hovers around 90 to 100. So the Panthers do have a pretty good defense led by Luke Kuechly. As for the Buccaneers and Saints, I can see the Buccaneers winning maybe 3 or 4 more games, but as for the Saints will probably get that number one spot. Or number one draft pick.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was trying to find out what this record is, because you've got to quantify between eras. Because if you go by just ever, a bunch of teams in the 30s only allowed 40 points. And that there, you can't count that. That is not what NFL is now.
We'll take the Super Bowl era.
So I'm trying to find that out. It's not exactly being that easy to find. We might have to save that for next week.
Yeah, might have to. Okay, the NFC East. So many close teams in this division. We have the Eagles at 4-3. We have the Redskins at 4-3. We have the Cowboys at 3-3, and then the Giants 1-6.
And the Giants, after taking week 1 against the Cowboys in a controversial win, it seems like karma's just been beating them over the head with a baseball bat since.
Oh, I definitely agree. I don't think the Giants...
No, the Giants, they're done. They are cooked.
Yeah.
Football in New York is over for this season. The New Yorkers have put away their jerseys. They are in hiding right now. They're done. The Redskins are pretty intriguing. They just got a new coach, and we have yet to see what his play style will look like in the league. If I had to pick a team right now, I would go with the Cowboys to take the division. They're only half a game back at 3-3. They have the best point differential of the three teams in contention. They're the only one with a positive point differential. The Eagles are somehow 4-3 while giving up 210 points to only scoring 169.
And mind you, the Giants have allowed 215. That's pretty terrible right there.
That's also says something. The Eagles are 4-3 and have given up 5 less points than the Giants. So that kind of shows they're kind of right there on that. We're above 500 now, but we could end up with only 5-6 wins.
I would say, for this division, I agree with you. The Cowboys, they'll get in the playoffs. Whether it be wild card or division. I'm going to say division. But I'm going to say the Redskins will push for that division title as well. But we have, I haven't seen much from the Redskins to know.
Well, I know a little about the Redskins coach, and he brings a college option style offense to the Capitol. So he is perfectly suited for RG3. So it depends on if he stays healthy.
I agree with you. He's been dealing with injuries, but you know, it's kind of hard to go against Dez Bryant and Tony Romo.
Yes, I think the Cowboys will take it. The Redskins are an intriguing look, but the Cowboys, I feel, are the class of the division.
All right, NFC West. Sorry to interrupt.
That's fine. We need to move along. We're getting a little long in the tooth.
Yeah. The NFC West, 49ers 6-2. The Rams 3-4. Well, the Rams, Cardinals, and Seahawks are all 3-4. What are your thoughts?
After last week's Titanic showdown where the 49ers went into St. Louis and beat the Rams 26-24, it's their division to lose. Oh, this week's showdown. Sorry. It still happened. The 49ers still went in. They stole their lunch money. They punched him in the gut and left laughing. 6-2. They are two and a half games up on the division. I think the 49ers have it. If they're in control of their own destiny.
I agree with you. You know, the Rams played a tough game, a really tough game. You know, we could feel the frustration that the 49ers were having during that game. But, like you said, they came out, they stole the Rams' lunch money by the skin of their teeth, no less. You know, by 2 points, two measly points, they came out victorious with the field goal. It was a nice game. Nicely played. You know, Kaepernick, you know, managed the offense. Hyde was getting it done. He had a great run game going. But Kaepernick threw over 300 yards. Can't be too sure.
Yes, he threw. Kaepernick threw for 381.
Whew, yes. But
yeah, Kaepernick was golden today.
Yeah, he was.
Carlos Hyde, 95 yards rushing.
How many carries did Carlos Hyde have?
15. That was what hurt the Rams. Their play calling has been all over the place. Rams running backs had 12 carries. Nick Foles had 5 runs by himself. You can't.
Yeah, I believe Nick Foles led the team in rushing yards, did they not?
43 yards for Nick Foles, 10 for Trey Mason, 9 for David Johnson, and 7 for Todd Gurley. How he's not getting Todd Gurley involved in this offense is mind-boggling to me.
I don't get it either. I don't get it either. But that matchup was really, really good this week.
And the Rams...
With that, let's... continue on.
The Rams, they seem to have a good team. They can play it close, but they seem to fall short in these games. And I feel like this game with the 49ers, I feel like they will end up putting together and getting the wild card. They've got some favorable matchups. The Vikings, Bears, Cardinals, Lions, Bucks. I think that's 5 wins right there. But these games against users, they keep coming down to that last drive against the Packers, an interception with 20 seconds left. And now against the 49ers, they went up with a minute left and let the 49ers drive right down to the 15 and kick basically what was an extra point last year to win it.
Yeah.
You got to look at the play style. I don't believe without getting Todd Gurley. Todd Gurley, he is your guy. He is your number one. Give him the rock and let him just rumble. And he has not been seeing the ball in this offense. And it is a shame because he is a great player. Give him the ball, St. Louis. Please, give Todd Gurley the ball.
I agree. Todd Gurley needs to demand that ball. He needs to.
He is a man!
All right, that brings... yeah. Give me the ball, coach. Anyway, that brings us to the matchups, okay? For this week, the games that jump out at you. All right. My 3 games that jump out at me: the Dolphins and Patriots.
Okay. Yes, that's the biggest game. That's Thursday Night Football, baby. Who doesn't love that? But yeah, that's a big one.
The Seahawks and Cowboys. Again, and that's one game that I'm gonna pay close attention to. And then the Packers and Broncos. What are your three matchups that you think?
I think you hit the nail on the head there. The Dolphins and that could give control of the AFC East.
I like how you added the East.
I'm sorry. I like both of those teams, but the Broncos, I feel, have been just... I feel like they're heading towards at worst 13-3 season. And that's with resting some players at the end of the year. But, yeah. Patriots, Dolphins, Packers, and Broncos. That one is just... That one's going to be a fight. And Bengals, Steelers. The Steelers win it, they throw themselves back in the division. If they lose it, stick a fork in them.
All right, yeah. I was kind of juggling between the Bengals, Steelers, or the Seahawks, Cowboys. But there is another one that I was looking forward to: the Colts and the Panthers. But I think the matchups that we described are much bigger. Most of them, or 2 of them, are division matchups, but...
And one is a team on life support, but yes, I forgot about the Seahawks Cowboys. That one's a big one. That's another team on life support.
What is your surprise game of the week? Like, who do you think will get a surprise victory over their opponent?
My upset watch, I'm gonna say that's actually pretty hard. There's not really very many upset candidates this week because the Buccaneers, they're not taking down the Falcons. It is not happening. The Falcons would have to have a plane crash for that to happen. I'm gonna say the Jets get their first win of the season in a Heidi Bowl rematch.
I was gonna say the same thing. The Jets over the Raiders. And yeah, I mean, it's expected that the Raiders will win over the Jets based on record, based on play, but I think the Jets will come out with their first victory. But another surprise, I think, can happen. And it might not seem like a surprise to you or to everybody else, but my surprise pick would be the Colts over the Panthers.
That was the one I was going to say, but I felt Jets-Raiders would be a big... Colts upsetting the Panthers would be big.
That would be big. It would shake up the playoff wild card for the NFC, and it would propel the Colts into that division title. But with that, let's look at the division leaders right now, the playoff picture. The AFC, we have the Dolphins are the number one team. All right. The Broncos are holding that second spot. So those two are the home field. Well, I wouldn't say home field advantage, but like the bye week for the playoffs right now. We have the Cincinnati Bengals are in third. We have the Colts are in fourth. Those are the division leaders, and then we have the Patriots and the Raiders. Which two teams do you think can insert themselves in the playoffs for the AFC?
For the wild card hunt?
The wild card or... Yeah.
Obviously,
in the playoffs.
We've got the Dolphins and Patriots, one of them are going to be wild card one. And number two, I would say the Chargers. The Chargers are going to make the wild card, I think. They're 5-3. The Raiders, they've lost two straight, so I think they're about to come back to earth. They're about to reach the meat of their schedule. They beat up a couple teams that... I mean, they stole one against the Broncos. And that's really their signature win, is the win over the Broncos. So I think it's going to go to
the Ravens, right? The Ravens won against the Broncos.
Oh.
Not the Ravens.
I keep getting them mixed up. First show.
But, I mean, I do agree with you. I think the Chiefs, or not the Chiefs, the Chargers, can... first up, the Oakland Raiders. But
if we
want to
talk,
close one of the match.
If we want to talk dark horse candidates, I think the Jaguars could be a dark horse candidate to actually take the South. They've won three straight. They're 3-4. They're right behind the Colts. They're breathing down their necks. They could be a dark horse to take it all in the South. The Chiefs are my dark horse pick to make the wild card. They've won four straight.
That is pretty neat. I like what you're thinking. For me, I think my dark horse would be the Ravens taking over the North. And then the Bengals getting the wild card.
I could see
over
that.
Or the Raiders. The Raiders or Chargers. But, you know, I like the choices that you've made because... you can't ignore the Jaguars' three-game win streak. You can't ignore the Oakland Raiders falling from that 4-0 start. And you can't ignore how the Chargers have been playing these last couple of weeks. You know, And they even beat the Ravens. So they will have a one-up over the Ravens for that wild card spot if the Ravens do compete for it. But, you know, I do think Miami will get end up being in the wild card instead of New England. But as of right now, if it ended today, the Raiders would be in. And I mean, it would be a lot of interesting teams there. For the NFC, the division leaders are the Falcons, Green Bay Packers, San Francisco 49ers, the Philadelphia Eagles, and then we have two more from the AFC or the NFC South, the Carolina Panthers and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Who are your candidates, your two candidates, two teams, to jump into the playoffs? Most likely to jump into the playoffs.
I think the Panthers have that wild card spot locked down. And then I think the Rams are going to get the second wild card spot. Because I think to get the second wild card spot, you need to have it. It'll be a 9-win team in the NFC, I believe.
All right. Who are your two dark horse candidates to make it into the NFC? There are, granted, there's not many.
Yeah, everything's just so close. It's hard to pick a dark horse when everyone's separated for that wild card range by just a game. I'd say the Redskins are a dark horse to take the NFC East. Even though they're tied for first right now, we haven't really seen them with their new coach. But I'm going to say he pulls the upset and takes the division. For dark horse wild card, it's hard to say. I'd say the Cardinals.
I was gonna say the Seahawks, but continue on with your choice.
The Cardinals have lost three straight, and you gotta look. They lost three straight. This might actually affect my choice. I'm gonna go look at their injuries right now. They started off 3-1 and have fallen to 3-4. Something's got to be up with that.
Yeah, oh, but they do face.
Oh
the
no, they have. They are. I think they're cooked. This kind of injuries. Andre Ellington, 3 weeks, dislocated elbow. Patrick Peterson, he's out 2 more weeks with a broken toe. Michael Floyd, 3 weeks with a pulled groin. The biggest, Carson Palmer. Broken collarbone. 3 weeks. They picked up Steven Jackson to help with that running back position. Broken collarbone out 4 weeks. I'm switching to the Seahawks.
Alright. Yeah, I mean, right now, I think the Seahawks are just... they're really my dark horse. But, you know, it's a really tough NFC right this year. With the leaders. As for the bottom feeders, there's a lot in the NFC, but there are a few in the AFC as well. But I think the Seahawks, if they win against the Cowboys, I think they have a really good chance. But if the Cowboys win, obviously I feel they will take the division. But it comes again to how our top three matchups are, you know, it could drastically change the feel of the playoff picture.
Yeah. Anything else you want to talk about, or you want to call it a wraps on week one?
I think let's give a rundown of who the statistic leaders.
Okay, and we can give a look at the MVP and the award races too.
Oh, all right, yeah.
That's going to be next week. I'm sorry. Because we're week 8. Yeah. I believe the yearly awards, they're not available yet.
How about you do the offense, and I'll do the defense. All right,
for passing, for quarterbacks.
Just, like, name the top 5.
Yeah. If we're going to look at passer rating top 5 starters... Got Matt Ryan. He's got a 143.4 rating. He's thrown 1,700 yards. Almost 18. Let's just... 1,800 yards. 19 touchdowns. Only 5 picks. He is completing 81% of his passes. And that right there, that's why the Falcons are just... They're just lighting it on fire. Coming in second, you got Peyton Manning. 142.3. Again, it's barely separated. I think yards is what gives Ryan the edge. Peyton's thrown for about 1,500 yards. 20 touchdowns to an amazing 2 interceptions. Just 2. Peyton is on fire. 71% completion percentage. Third, Tom Brady. He's got a 115.4 rating. He's thrown for almost 2,000 yards. 18 touchdowns to 10 interceptions. He's turned the ball over a bit, but he's completing 76% of his passes. Fourth, we have Aaron Rodgers. A 112.9 rating. He's thrown for almost 1,600 yards, 10 touchdowns, just 3 interceptions. You might say his touchdown numbers are kind of low. Had a lot of times where the receivers are tackled at the 2-yard line. We'll get to that with Eddie Lacy. He's completing 67% of his passes, kind of a little bit low. But the Packers are 6-0. And then bringing up fifth, got Mike Glennon. Mike Glennon starting for the injured Carson Palmer. Kind of making people think he's going to take over full time. 108.8 passer rating. 1,400 yards passing, 11 touchdowns, and just 2 picks. 2 picks for the former Tampa Bay starter. He's only completing 59% of his passes, though. And they have lost the 3 games he started. So it's kind of hard to... You got to take it with a grain of salt. For the rushing leaders, it's just clear cut. Tevin Coleman. 1,000 yards rushing in 7 games. He is a candidate as a rookie to break the NFL rushing record. 1,000 yards, 11 touchdowns. He's fumbled once. He's averaging 152 yards a game. 9 20-plus yard runs. He is just lighting the league on fire as a rookie. You got Jamaal Charles. 751 yards rushing, 5 touchdowns, averaging 6.7 yards per carry. And Tevin Coleman, sorry, 7.6 yards per carry for Tevin Coleman on 140 carries. He is just outstanding. Third, you've got CJ Anderson, 716 yards on 138 carries, 8 touchdowns, averaging 5.2 yards per carry. Doing pretty good. Fourth, you got Marshawn Lynch, 712 yards on 138 carries. Pretty much carbon copy with CJ Anderson, except 6 touchdowns. Fifth, you've got DeMarco Murray, 710 yards on 116 carries, 6.1 yard per carry average, 3 touchdowns. Not bad for the former Oklahoma and former Dallas Cowboys starter. Honorable mention, we've got Eddie Lacy with 13 touchdowns. 13 for the Packers.
Tearing it up.
6 games, 13 touchdowns. That's where Aaron Rodgers' touchdowns are. For receiving, it is a tight end league right now when it comes to receptions, at least. So we're going to be going this one by yards. As Vernon Davis, he's still number one in both. 45 catches, 868 yards, 9 touchdowns. He has just found the fountain of youth and is tearing it up in San Francisco. Second, we've got AJ Green. 30 catches, 791 yards, 8 touchdowns. He's just going out there and working for the 5-2 Bengals. Third, there's T.Y. Hilton. 37 catches, 693 yards, 4 touchdowns. He is the Colts' number one guy. If he doesn't get going, the Colts aren't winning. Fourth, Jordy Nelson, 692 yards on 38 catches, 4 touchdowns for the Green Bay Packers. He is the number one target in that offense and should be for years to come. And then fifth, we've got a surprise, a resurrection in the desert. Mike Williams, 638 yards on 36 catches, 4 touchdowns. He's working in place of the injured Michael Floyd. Honorable mention on catches, you got Rob Gronkowski, 43 catches, 597 yards, 3 touchdowns. Jared Cook, 40 catches, 536 yards, 5 touchdowns. Antonio Gates, 39 catches, 517 yards, 1 touchdown. Tight ends are leading the way in catching passes, but yardage, you still got to give it up to the wide receiver. So really, for defense.
All right. Right now, we're doing total tackles, and the leading tackler is Bobby Wagner with 69. 46 total tackles, or 46 solo, 23 assists. He is a tackle machine. He's averaging at least, let's see, Seattle, or what, 7 games? He's averaging at least about close to 10 total tackles a game. We have Steven Tulloch for the Detroit Lions. 67 tackles, 33 solo, 33 assisted. Not bad, but it seems Tulloch needs more help than himself, just himself. Next, we have CJ Mosley with 65 tackles. You know, 34 solo, 31 assisted. Darryl Washington in Arizona, tied, 65 tackles, 48 solo. I believe he leads in solo tackles. He does with 48. Yes. He only has 17 assisted.
He's doing it by himself.
Yeah, by himself, basically. He is the defense. For tackles for a loss, Dante Hightower for the New England Patriots. He leads with 12. That's astonishing. Getting at least 1.5 or so per game. Maybe 2.
Yeah, well, he doesn't make actually a whole lot of impact on on every down basis. He comes up with those big plays that help you win games.
Definitely. CJ Mosley, 11 tackles for a loss. He's a disruptor. Him in that Chargers game, he was just in the backfield tackling Melvin Gordon. Aaron Lynch, linebacker, San Francisco 49ers, 10 tackles for a loss. Just amazing. Terrell Suggs, another Raven linebacker, 10 tackles for a loss. And again, Alden Smith, 9 tackles for a loss. This Ravens linebacking core just really gets after the running back. Sacks leader, we have Vic Beasley Jr., arguably the Defensive Rookie of the Year.
Another Falcons rookie that is going after a record in his first season in the NFL.
Exactly. I think this would be the first time that two rookies from the same team win Rookie of the Year.
Oh, yeah.
Next, we have
Pete
Carradine. 5.5 sacks. KJ Wright for the Seattle Seahawks. 5 sacks. Wow. Coming from that linebacker position. Cameron Jordan tied, 5 sacks. New Orleans Saints, even though the Saints aren't getting things done, he's there. He's being a playmaker.
Still working.
Still trucking. And then Corey Redding, 4.5 sacks for the Arizona Cardinals. And I'd like to mention somebody who's getting it done. Where are they? That I noticed was just fucking beasting. Okay. Brian Cushing, who has 45 tackles, solo tackles, 15 assists, and 60 total. He's getting in the backfield. He has 3 sacks. That might not seem like a lot, but he's coming from a Mike linebacker position.
He's the guy that he's the guy that they're looking to block on every play. He's playing in coverage and he's still getting down and getting 3 sacks. And he's been their lone run stopper from the linebacking core.
Definitely. You don't hear J.J. Watt in that discussion, even though J.J. Watt probably
There was a coaching change that he was a very poor fit. He did get an overtime win in his last game, but he forced a 4-3 on the Texans. That does not take advantage of J.J. Watt. That does not take advantage of Whitney Merciless. That does not take advantage of Jadeveon Clowney. You can't do that to the Texans.
All right, interception leaders. We have Reggie Nelson, free safety for the Cincinnati Bengals, causing those turnovers. Devin McCourty, New England Patriots, again, another safety, 5 interceptions, tying for the lead. He has also had 1 sack, so he gets in the backfield plenty, or he's able to. Morgan Burnett, another safety, strong safety this time, very huge player. 4 interceptions, 132 interception yards,
two
touchdowns. Wow.
He's
going to get a Pro Bowl mention.
Sorry to interrupt. Last interception was a game-winning pick 6 against the Chargers.
That went for 72 yards, correct?
Yes, that was a coast-to-coast game winner for Morgan Burnett.
All right, Desmond Trufant, the first cornerback that we're talking about, he leads with 4 interceptions for the Falcons. Wow, what a playmaker. And a linebacker makes this list, Darrell Washington. I believe I already talked about him, leading the league in solo tackles. He is the leading linebacker in interceptions, making a stand.
I'd give it up to multi-purpose. Luke Kuechly. Luke Kuechly. He's tied for 3 as well, but he's got 105 interception return yards and a touchdown.
Oh, yeah. He is doing him and Ben Rickery. They're just getting to the house,
Oh, yeah.
Just getting to the house. All right. Pass deflection. James Laurinaitis, middle linebacker, St. Louis Rams, getting it done, knocking those passes with this huge frame. Mike Adams, strong safety for Indianapolis Colts, 7 pass deflections. And then we have a substantial number of people tied with 6. One of them being Luke Kuechly again. Greg Toler, cornerback, Indianapolis. Gerard Powers, not a known cornerback for the Arizona Cardinals, but he's getting those deflections. Ryan Kerrigan, who is a disruptor on all fronts, 3.5 sacks, 3 interceptions, 6 pass deflections. All right, forced fumbles. It has been basically just two guys that are just popping out with them. Michael Kendricks, middle linebacker, Philadelphia Eagles, with 3, and C.J. Mosley with 3, and then a substantial amount of people with 2, including Vic Beasley Jr. Like, that rookie is going crazy. Fumble recoveries, there's just a lot of people with 1. Aaron Williams, safety, Buffalo Bills. Calais Campbell, left end, Arizona Cardinals. James Laurinaitis with 1. One lone field goal block, Jadeveon Clowney. Wow. You don't see those often.
6.
And the leading leader in defensive touchdowns. We've already touched on it. Morgan Burnett, strong safety, Green Bay. And then a lot of people with one touchdown. T.J. Ward of the Denver Broncos, safety, one touchdown. I believe that was an interception touchdown as well. And then another one, K.J. Wright, Seattle Seahawks, one touchdown. Just, and that was fumble recovery, 44 yards. Man, just a lot of plays going down. A lot of interceptions, a lot of tackles, a lot of sacks, especially for that rookie in Atlanta. As for the kickers, I won't touch too much on the kickers. You know, the leading kicker right now is Chandler Cantanzaro. I don't really know how to pronounce his name.
Yeah, Chandler Cantanzaro.
He leads with 14 field goals, 100% percentage. Yeah, there's a really good number of people who are 100%. The worst percentage is Blair Walsh. Unbelievable. 3 for 7, 42%. And then Sean Sweeson, 7 for 12, 58%. That's just sad. The longest field goal, though, was by Carey Spear, 60 yards. Wow.
Whew. 60.
60. And then we'll go on with special teams. We have quite a few with a kick return touchdown. Giovanni Bernard, huge for Cincinnati. Deshaun Jackson, he's a return monster, you know. Cordero Patterson, 102 yards, kick return touchdown, amazing. Brandon Cooks with 101 yard kick return touchdown. And then Richard Crawford, cornerback at San Diego, kick return touchdown. And not too many punt returns. We have Patrick Peterson, who is injured. He got a punt return touchdown. And then we have CJ Spiller. Not one of those guys where you think can, you know, turn on the burners, but he went 80 yards for a punt return touchdown. And that's our stats. Any closing thoughts, 2D?
Besides the fact that the Falcons are just burning down the league at this moment. It's like, I know Green Bay is 6-0, but it seems like a different kind of 6-0. Falcons have just dominated every game. Green Bay has come up lucky in 3 games this season to win.
For your game of the week, what is your game of the week? I know we went through top matchups, but what are your game of the week, and who do you think will be player of the week or player of the game of that game?
I think the game of the week is quite obviously the Broncos Packers. Got the 5-1 Broncos, the 6-0 Packers. Peyton Manning showing that the old man can still play, and Aaron Rodgers at the top of his game. It's going to be a tough one on Sunday night.
And
my player of the game,
player,
the winning quarterback. It's going to be the winning quarterback. I feel like it's going to go down to whoever has the ball last. We'll win this game.
I will agree with you, but I wouldn't say winning quarterback. I would say, actually, based on the ground game, all right? Because whoever establishes a good run game most likely will keep the ball and win the game. But that's it for this week. I'm Relicris.
I'm 2D. And this has been here Around the League. I know it was kind of a little rough, but I still think it was pretty fun.
I had fun too. I know it was just a little over an hour, but
had a lot to get into in that first week.
Definitely. Stay tuned for next Thursday. Much earlier time, I would assume.
Yes.
But thank you guys for watching.
And next week we'll have our MVP and award prediction.
All right, that sounds fun.
See you guys next week.